What's up? Taim Talks Med here. Let's continue our cranial nerve series. Cranial nerves are 12 pair of nerves that exit the brain and the brainstem. And in this segment, we will talk detailed about the fourth cranial nerve, which is the trochlear nerve. And we will do that by first making a quick scheme of the trochlear pathway to get an overview of it. Then we will cover the course of the trochlear nerve and go detailed into its pathway and which structures the trochlear nerve goes through. And while doing so, we will talk through the functions of the muscle the trochlear nerve innervates, the superior oblique muscle. And at the end, we will talk a little bit about the clinical relevance and pathologies related with the fourth cranial nerve pathway. So, the trochlear nerve is a fourth cranial nerve, and it gets its name from the Latin word pulley, trochlea. Now, a pulley is a device that lifts an object, right? In each eye, the superior oblique muscle functions as the trochlea, or a pulley. The trochlear nerve innervates the superior oblique muscle to lift the eye so that we can look down. So, the trochlear nerve innervates the superior oblique muscle to move the eye in a down and out position and in toward the eye. Let's see how it innervates it. The nerve starts from a nucleus called the nucleus of the trochlear nerve, located in the midbrain at the level of the inferior colliculus. From the nucleus of the trochlear nerve, the motor neuron will leave from the posterior surface of the midbrain, turn anteriorly, and enter and run on the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus. It then enters the orbit via the superior orbital fissure to innervate the superior oblique. The trochlear nerve is relatively easy. It's exclusively a somatomotor nerve, and it innervates only one muscle, the superior oblique muscle. All right, so this is the general overview of the trochlear nerve. Now what we're going to do is cover this in a little more detail, starting from the beginning, at the midbrain. Now, if you look at this side view of the midbrain, we can see the spinal cord here, the medulla, cerebellum, pons, mesencephalon, and the diencephalon. And when we remove the cerebellum and focus on the brainstem from the posterior side, as you see here, you will see the mesencephalon, pons, and the medulla. So again, the mesencephalon, which is the midbrain, is what we're interested in for now. From the posterior view, we can see the cerebral peduncles, as well as the tectal plates. And you know, the tectal plate consists of the superior colliculi, involved in incorporating environmental stimuli and coordinating gaze shifts involved in head and eye movements. We can see the brachium of the superior colliculus, which is a connection arm between the superior colliculus and the lateral geniculate bodies. And we got the inferior colliculus, which take in sound information and send them further up to the medial geniculate bodies through the brachium of the inferior colliculi. All right, so that was the external view. Now what I want to do is take this model and cut it right about here at the level of the inferior colliculi. Then we're going to remove the upper part and look at it from this perspective. We will see this. Here we see the inferior colliculi, the cerebral peduncles, the interpeduncular space, and the aqueduct of the midbrain, which connects the fourth ventricle to the third ventricle. Now, within the midbrain, we can find the inferior colliculi. So keep in mind, this is at the level of the inferior colliculi. And there are a bunch of other structures here, like the substantia nigra and the periaqueductal gray matter. But what's important now for us to know is that on the sides here, we got two nuclei called the nuclei of the trochlear nerve. When the fourth cranial nerve exits out of the midbrain, it's going to cross. So in other words, the nucleus of the fourth cranial nerve on the left side of the midbrain will go to the right eye. The nucleus on the right side of the midbrain will go to the left eye. It will exit on the posterior surface and move alongside the midbrain very tightly, and then come out anteriorly. So this is the nucleus. It's going to be found on the same places that you are going to see within the oculomotor nerve. It's just a little bit lower. The oculomotor nerve nuclei are at the level of the superior colliculi, and the trochlear nerve nuclei are at the level of the inferior colliculi. So that's that one. As we look at this figure, you will see that the trochlear nerve exits on the posterior surface of the midbrain at the level of the inferior colliculi. It then turns around the midbrain to continue anteriorly. Now, keep focusing your eyes on the trochlear nerve, and let's add some other structures. When the trochlear nerve leaves the posterior side of the midbrain, it turns anteriorly, it will pierce the dura mater and run on the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus, below the oculomotor nerve, to then run through the superior orbital fissure to innervate the superior oblique. And here we kind of get a different angle where you see the trochlear nerve going through the superior orbital fissure to innervate the superior oblique. It's a very straightforward nerve, this one. And I want to remind you again, we got 7 extraocular muscles. Lateral rectus is supplied by the 6th cranial nerve, the abducens nerve. Superior oblique is supplied by the 4th cranial nerve, the trochlear nerve. Everything else, the superior rectus, medial and inferior rectus, inferior oblique, as well as the levator palpebral superioris, are all supplied by the oculomotor nerve. Alright, now that we know that, we need to know what the actual superior oblique is doing. So, we know where it originates, we know the course of it, we know what it innervates, now what does it do, and then we will talk about the clinical correlation. Let's first understand its origin and insertion. One thing I want you guys to keep in mind is that the superior oblique muscle originates from the body of the sphenoid bone. So in contrast to the other extraocular muscles, the superior oblique and the inferior oblique do not originate from the common tendinous ring. Instead, the superior oblique originates medially to the tendinous ring. The superior oblique muscle runs anteriorly, and near its insertion, the muscle tendon hooks around a cartilaginous pulley called the trochlea of the superior oblique. From the trochlea, the tendons take a sharp posterior lateral turn before inserting onto the posterior superior lateral surface of the eye on the sclera. Now, before getting into the action of this muscle, it's important to highlight that in reality, almost all movements of the eyeball involve actions of at least 3 muscles. The movement of the eyeball need to be controlled, precise, and well coordinated to get a clear picture of the outside world. Now, when the muscle contracts, it actually pulls the tendinous connection this way. If it pulls this way, it pulls the eyeball downwards in that action, causing depression of the eyeball. And also, because it's pulling on the superior lateral surface, it's also going to adduct and internally rotate the eyeball too. So that's the function of this muscle. Now, the trochlear nerve is a very delicate nerve that is relatively easily damaged. And damage can be congenital or occur due to other causes like trauma. Because the superior oblique helps to move the eyeball downwards, when this nerve is damaged, the eye tends to deviate upwards since there is no opposing force coming from the superior oblique. And not only that, because the superior oblique causes internally rotation of the eyeball, if the main intorting muscle is affected, then what's the eye normally going to do? Extort. So, an isolated damage to the superior oblique muscle causes the eye to naturally shift upwards and externally rotate a little. This usually results in double vision, diplopia, since both eyes aren't coordinated anymore, and some patients will adapt to this condition and get a head tilt as a compensatory mechanism to better align the eyes and reduce the diplopia. Now, an isolated injury of this nerve is fairly rare, and is usually combined with injuries of other cranial nerves, but damage to the trochlear nerve can be either congenital or acquired, and congenital defects causes usually malformation of the nucleus or the nerve. Acquired damage can be due to trauma or midbrain stroke. Remember, fibers that emerge from the nucleus decussate before going out from the midbrain, resulting in contralateral symptoms when the nucleus is affected. But when the actual nerve is damaged, it causes ipsilateral symptoms on the same side. Alright, let's recap once again. The nucleus of the trochlear nerve is located in the midbrain at the level of the inferior colliculus. From the nucleus of the trochlear nerve, the fibers will leave from the posterior surface of the midbrain, turn anteriorly to enter and run on the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus. It then enters the orbit via the superior orbital fissure to innervate the superior oblique. The trochlear nerve is exclusively a somatomotor nerve and innervates only one muscle, the superior oblique. So that was everything I had for the fourth cranial nerve. The next video is going to be about the fifth cranial nerve, the trigeminal nerve. Thank you so much for watching another one of my videos. If you enjoyed, learned something from it, please remember to like, comment your favorite moment, subscribe, turn on those notifications. If you're looking for other ways to support, go ahead and check the link in the description box. Have fun, y'all. Peace.